All I want is to live as normal a life as possible. That's all I ask. I have to live my whole life with this. I have to live my whole life on medication, probably. And I just want to be treated humanely.
And we have learned of more than one person who have committed suicide because they were in such intense pain, and usually they were by themselves.
If I didn't have my husband, to help save my life through this situation, I wouldn't be here.
Yeah, and I know that I wouldn't be able to make it through a second round of this. It's just too hard. I don't know how anyone can.
She was so sick. I mean, I had pain, but she was really, really in agony. And I don't ever want to see anybody go through that again. Jeez.
Rat lungworm disease is caused by a worm, a little worm, a nematode, and it travels through, it reproduces in the rat, and it infects what's called an intermediate host, the slugs and snails. And the worm has to develop through slugs and snails to what we call the third stage larva. And that's what can be infective to rats, because rats eat the infected slugs or snails, and that completes the life cycle. Or that slug or snail can contaminate food. And most people that have been infected think anyway that they've been infected by eating contaminated food or water. It's a widespread problem. It's not just east side of Hawaii. We have had cases in Maui and on Oahu. We've had recent cases in Kona. So it's not just the Puna area.
See, I think we've interviewed four households for a total of six people. The people we interviewed ranged from educators to a farmer, a scientist, a graphic designer, and an individual who owned RV dealerships and was involved in sales.
I am Shauna Rose, and I live in Kapoho, Hawaii, of course. And I am a stay-at-home farmer, gardener, beekeeper. And I remember seeing the slugs in my garden and thinking, well, I'm going to wash these greens. Rains all the time. There was no education about it. And part in the back of my mind was like, slugs, maybe, problem, but not enough, obviously, to pay the kind of attention I should have.
Well, my name is Sherry Palmer, and we live in Va'ava, very close to here, and I do graphics design. So.
And I'm Rex Palmer, and I'm a retired biology teacher.
Yes, we knew about Shauna and David.
Yeah, and we knew already that the organism was around, and that you could maybe get it from snails.
I'm David Johnson. We live here in Keauau, Hawaii. We also live some of the time in Seattle, Washington. And this is my wife, Lisa.
Jeremiah Can. I live here in Hilo, Hawaii. I'm an educator, farmer, gardener, artist. I'm from originally Jamaica, an island in the Caribbean, and lived on Oahu and taught with Shazi also in the schools, educating about growing food and sustainability.
My name is Shazi Can, and I live here in Hilo, Hawaii. And I've grown up on Oahu since I was a teenager, a young adult, and we moved over here about 2.5 years ago. And then we also lived here about 10 years ago.
A lot of people don't know exactly how they became infected. Most of the cases that have been reported, people are infected by eating contaminated food, where the slime of the slug or a little bit of the slug, if it's infected, gets on fresh produce and it's not properly washed. That's one way people can get infected in smoothies. We have additional evidence now that suggests that people can get infected from unfiltered catchment water.
Oh, I know that I got it from my garden, and as did two other people that ate salads from my garden at the time.
And we had no idea what it was.
Right.
But at the same time, the parmarions, the climbing slugs, showed up. Well, then, yeah, I think it was 2 years later, Sherry and I and Dave Paul all went to some potluck over here somewhere, and I forget how long after, but then after that one night, all of a sudden, just bam, just like somebody driving a nail into the top of my shoulder here, right? The muscle all spasmed up and everything. And just practically sobbing in pain.
Well, I would have to say I know how I got it, because I made that raw food smoothie with the lettuce, the red leaf lettuce, and that was the day after Halloween last year. I remember going to the market, the Hilo market that I go every Saturday, to get fresh green produce, which is the most healthiest way, and washing the lettuce, shaking it off, pulling off the leaves, sticking it in the blender, and adding the carrots and the tomatoes and the other vegetable smoothie, because very healthy inclined. After that event, 23 days later, when they did a spinal tap on me and identified that it was rat lung worm that I was being afflicted with, that was how I know that it had to be at that point in time.
We generally warn people to not handle slugs or snails with your bare hands. Use gloves, use a designated set of tongs that will not be used in food preparation. As far as whether the larva can penetrate skin, there's some early studies that suggest, at least in mice, that it can.
Well, we have a big agave plant out in the front of the house, and it was getting eaten up. I went out there and I got down by the roots, and there was tons and tons of slugs. And so I had a coffee, and I'd been working in the yard, so I had rough and tough hands, cuts all over myself. I think nothing of it. I grab all these slugs, I fill this coffee can full of these slugs, I think nothing of it, and I scrub up my hands, and 10 days later, I am completely as sick as can be. I can't take any light, I can't take any noise. Well, the very first thing I did was shut off lights and took all that away, and took noise away from, no TV, that sort of thing, and just had everything really quiet in the house. And
went to the doctor.
I went to the doctor, and the doctor said, you seem to be sick with something. And we were in and out of many hospitals.
Well, thinking about the parasite traveling through the body, a GI upset, because it transverses the intestines, and then it travels to the brain eventually. And when it's in the brain, it can cause all sorts of neurological problems. People report extreme headaches. Tingling of the skin, because it's affecting the nervous system. People have actually gone into comas and become paralyzed. Depends on the severity of the infection.
It started out with, I would be awakened in the night with severe pain in my shoulder. And I had had a shoulder injury, and that was sort of where the pain was. Although it was a minor shoulder injury, and this was just such severe pain that I was in tears. And night after night after night, the pain in the shoulder, and then it went up into my head. I started getting some skin sensitivity, but for me it was mostly these horrific headaches
Right. I was, you know, fine 1 minute, and the next minute I was in agonizing pain.
Right.
And I was terrified because there was no cause effect, you know.
Right.
It's not like stubbing your toe and going, ow, you know. And so we didn't know what in the world it was. With me, my neck just got paralyzed, my arm was paralyzed, my knee hurt, and my upper back was just in agonizing, firing nerve pain.
The very first symptoms were fever. We both woke up 3 nights in a row, drenched in sweat in our beds. Our jaws were grinding while we were sleeping and locking. We had a lot of tension in our necks and our jaws, a lot of sweating, and we just felt really sick. We felt really sick. And that was about the first week. And then week two, our nerves, your skin starts crawling.
Yeah.
And it's almost as if every wound, every owie, every scar, every injury you've ever had in your entire life is recorded in your central nervous system. And when this happens to you, all of those come back. You start to feel every place where, oh, I've had stitches, oh, I hurt myself there, oh, I found... So there's a sort of a memory that comes. And then by the second or third week, I was walking with a cane because my whole right side was paralyzed and I couldn't walk anymore. And Jeremiah had to help me use the restroom and walk me places. And then your vision becomes very sensitive. You need to wear sunglasses inside the house. Your computer screen's really bright. It's too hard to look at. So your central nervous system goes under attack. So anything that has to do with your central nervous system, your taste, your eyes, your hearing, your smell, touch, we didn't want... If Jeremiah was sitting this close to me, I would say, you're too close to me. You're in my space, or don't touch me, because it hurts. There's a sense or a force field around us, and it becomes extremely painful. Even though nobody's touching you, you can feel this because somehow the worms go inside and hack into your bioelectrical system or your motherboard, your central nervous system, and start creating havoc. So you really realize, and your skin's crawling. There's actually something under your skin. There's worms under your skin, and it feels like your skin's crawling. So that's a dead giveaway that there's something in your body that's foreign. And there's something invasive that's in there, because you just feel like it's not your body anymore and you're not in control.
Yes. My tummy, my appetite, felt like I had a really bad stomach flu that turned into fever, shivers, scratchy, serious lower back pain, going up the spine, very stiff, very hard to move your neck, and a pounding migraine headache that does not go away. No matter what you do, no matter what you take, it doesn't go away. And I prayed for sleep, because sometimes it's so painful you can't sleep. Which is very challenging, because your body only repairs when you're at sleep.
Mm-hmm. I forgot that. I had a headache for 5 days. There was an excruciating, right back here, there was my jaw and neck and everything locked up. And it's the worst headache you've ever had in your entire life. And just feels like your head is being pounded against the concrete.
Shazi felt the worms eating into her brain.
Yep.
That was her exact words to say, something is eating in my brain.
Yeah.
As they were chomping.
And then also, somehow they affected my neck and shoulders. So I would get these random,
tremors.
Almost like electric shock therapy.
Yeah.
Or maybe a seizure, where the muscles would just start spasming. And I couldn't move my shoulders or lift my head and neck or anything. They would just, it was like someone's putting a live wire straight onto my shoulders and electrocuting me.
Our bodies would tremor and spasm.
As far as medical treatment and doctors recognizing this is when a patient comes in, we seem to still get reports that were similar to what happened when my son was infected, and I was working out of the country, and my sister took him into the ER and suggested initially that he may have rat lungworm disease. He had symptoms of it, and they insisted that it was flu and sent him home, and she took him back a couple days later and said, no, you really need to put him on steroids. This is rat lungworm disease. And they said, no, it's flu, and sent him home again. And then when he couldn't urinate, they had to admit him. And this happened to the woman who went into a coma right before my son, completely unrelated cases. And we continue to hear reports of that, that somebody goes into the emergency room and is turned away.
At one point, I went to the doctor, an established doctor here in Hilo, and he said, well, I don't think you have it. By then, a neighbor had already said, I think this is what you have. Because he's a doctor, he'd had it, he knew. And this doctor said, I've never heard of it, so you don't have it. I went to the clinic, they didn't know anything. But what I was told was, there's nothing that can be done. You're just gonna have to sit through it. This is, you know, I knew what it was at that time. I don't think the medical, I mean, we in this community knew a lot more about it than the medical community did at the time.
And so I went to the doctor at Kaiser, I think probably 24 hours later, and explained to him what it was. He's a new guy from the mainland, had never heard of it.
Wrote it down on a piece of paper.
Wrote it down on a piece of paper. Convinced him to give me prednisone, and he said he would order up a test, right? Well, the test came back. It was just a general helminth test.
It was the wrong test.
Right, wrong test. I don't have intestinal roundworms. So, again, you know, here's the doctor just with no experience with tropical disease, but at least he listened and he gave his prednisone. So,
finally, he got so bad that we had to go to the hospital. I think you were in three hospitals altogether. The first hospital, when we went in, they just wanted to give him some pain medicine and send him home. They didn't even want to do any tests. The second one, they kept him and did some testing on him, but they couldn't seem to figure out what was the matter. And at that time, we didn't know anything about rat lung. And my brother happened to come over from Oregon to visit my folks, and he took my mom into the doctor, and there was a poster at the doctor's office that gave a description of rat lung, you know, symptoms. If you have these symptoms, you may, and my brother took a picture of it with his phone and sent it and said, you know, gee, this sounds an awful lot like what you're describing. And so then we took that in to our doctor, and fortunately our family practitioner, although he did not really have a clue about what it was, he took the time to read the information, and he said, well, just in case, we're going to treat it like it is.
He did.
He went to bat.
He went to bat, and he probably saved us from me being permanently paralyzed.
I think the second or third time I tried to get into the hospital, Hilo Medical Center, we tried a few times, and we also went to see our doctor, and I also went to see a naturopath. And the doctor told me to use lotion for the itching, and they turned us away. And then the second time I actually questioned my doctor at Hilo Medical Center, and I said, are you sure we don't have rat lungworm? Because our eosinophils are up. And he said, no, there's probably just a small virus, and then released us.
Many times the diagnosis is indirect. It is a hard disease to diagnosed because of the wide variety of symptoms. And so when somebody eats a piece of lettuce or a smoothie that has larvae in it, the larvae penetrate through the intestines, and then they travel via the bloodstream to the central nervous system. And so then basically the larvae travels to the brain and stays there until the parasite dies. So the forms of diagnoses include symptoms, what types of symptoms that people are exhibiting, as well as their history. They can take a small sample of cerebral spinal fluid and actually look for the parasite in the cerebral spinal fluid. That's a definitive test. They can do that visually through with a microscope, or they can use a molecular test to detect the DNA of the parasite in their cerebral spinal fluid.
Well, I went to my doctor and asked for an antibody test.
At Kaiser, Danhauser,
who was a very good doctor, and she spent part of her life in Southeast Asia, so she was aware of this, and she, you know, ordered the test for me, and it came back positive. And I actually had a friend at the same time who had the same exact symptoms I had. And she went to her doctor, and her doctor told her she had rotator cuff injury. And when I got the results of my test back, I told her, and she went into her doctor to ask for that. And her doctor said, "That's not here. You don't have that. We don't have that." And she insisted, and he said, "Well, it's your blood. You can do what you want with it." And so he gave her the test, and it came back positive. And even when it came back positive, he said, "Well, you didn't get that here. You got it someplace else, maybe in your travels someplace." So, you know, that's the difference between knowing about tropical disease and not.
So we flew our auntie over. We flew our Hanai mom over, and we got our auntie. And we coordinated on a Sunday when to go to Hilo Medical Center. And we arrived, and they checked us in. And there was one doctor that took us both, and she said, "I don't know what to do with you two, so I'm going to refer you to two other doctors." And then they split us up. So then I had a doctor with my Hanai mom, and Jeremiah had our auntie, and he went to the other doctor. And the other doctor was a little more willing to investigate. My doctor told me to give a shishi sample, and then left it on the counter and walked out of the room and never came back in to see me, and then I was released. So this is the second time. So as my auntie's pushing me out in a wheelchair with my cane, a nurse comes running down the hall and says, "Wait, wait, wait. You have to come back. We have to check you in again. We're gonna give you a spinal tap." And so—
Because the emergency room doctor that saw me, and this is my second time, being in the emergency room
at Hilo Medical,
seeing my blood work from the previous time that I was there, 10 days previously, and the high white blood cell count, which is indicative of viruses and also the rat lungworm disease, he said to me, "Would you be willing to receive a spinal tap?" And I says, "I'm really willing to receive anything. I'm in so much pain. I have no idea what it is. I need a diagnosis. And this was the 23rd of November, a week before Thanksgiving. "We need a diagnosis." He came back, he gave me the spinal tap. Very gentle man, just wonderful. Got a count of 1,000 in my cerebral spinal fluid. Immediately, hold Shazi. She needed to get corroborating evidence also. She received a spinal tap. She had a 600 count.
So the recovery process, it really depends upon how severe the case was. Some people are able to recover fully, but often the process is very long and painful, even in the cases, the few that I do know that recovered fully. Some people have had to learn how to walk again. Their vision has been affected. Their hearing has been affected. They have sexual dysfunction. They have bladder and bowel dysfunction. And those things don't seem to necessarily come back. So they are affected with that possibly for the rest of their life.
The regeneration process is way more difficult than the destruction process. So rat lungworm disease will destroy your senses 1 to 3 weeks, 45 days. And the regeneration process, we're on 7 months. And my doctors have told me there's nothing more they can do for me. And from what I hear from other rat lungworm victims is that these symptoms can go on for years ahead. So I'm at this point right now where I'm very unsure about what my future holds with my body and my healing process.
And even today, even now,
yeah.
I still experience spasms.
7 months later.
7 months later, with all the worms dead, guaranteed, I still have spasm, I still have sensitive skin, which it affects the dominant side of your body. So the half right-hand side of my body is way more sensitive than the left-hand side. And like I have a permanent sunburn. In an essence of sensation.
Or frostbite.
Or
that's
frost,
the best way we can describe it to people.
A few years ago, I started getting nerve pain again. And, you know, I've been very careful what I've been eating, so it was not like I was getting rat lungworm again. And I went to the physical therapist, and she said the same thing happened to people in the 50s with, polio.
Yeah.
That about 7 to 10 years later, people would start getting nerve pain when the nerves regrow in the sheath. So that happened, and then to this day I can't straighten my arm.
Plus your knee is...
And my knee, I have to do exercises for my knee.
Pain, I have extreme pain at times. And
nerve issues.
Nerve issues.
Memory issues.
My memory. It's terribly hard when... You know, my long-term memory is pretty darn good. Short-term memory, though, I mean, even if I'm going to the grocery store and I can't remember what I was there for or why I even went there in the first place, you know, your quality of life fades quite quickly. You know, it's not all of a sudden, you know, the nice car or the nice boat or this or that, it's all about, well, how can I make it through the next 8 hours until I can take a nap. And
I know an individual that was one of the first people in the cluster of cases that came about after the turn of the millennium, and 10 years plus, she's still on pain medication, and she is one of the people that we did interview.
My limitation was severe pain in about a third of my body, skin pain. That was what I was left with. Skin pain so bad that if I didn't have any pain relief, I wouldn't have wanted to live. Like many of the people I knew that did threaten suicide, and they commit suicide, even some of them who had this disease, and I understand why. Yeah. It's like having third-degree burns or something like that. So I was able to get a medication that seemed to make me stabilize. And I'm like, okay, this is the amount of pain I can live with. And I was always very naturally oriented. I never took drugs. I ate perfectly. And here I am. I can't garden. I can't eat salads. And I'm taking drugs. It's like, this was not the world I imagined for myself.
Has it gotten any better?
It's never changed since that first year. It's always the same. It gets worse if my back pain acts up. It kind of triggers my whole nervous system. And my other pain gets much worse. I guess, you know, for me it was like having the medication that enabled me to live as normal a life as possible.
Pain medication, I've heard people say everything from gabapentin to strong opiates, which are regulated and very difficult to get. Especially here in East Hawaii, there's a tendency for the health organizations to feel that there's misuse of pain medication. And so many people are questioned. It becomes very difficult for them to get them. One individual had to leave the state in order to be able to get her pain medication. And it's not necessarily a fun thing to be on pain meds for the rest of your life. I do know individuals who were infected here who have tried to get off their medication, and it's extremely difficult. The level of pain is just too intense.
They are trained to be suspicious of anyone using any kinds of opiates. And so the suspicion, the humiliation, the degradation that I was treated with here by the medical system made me want to leave. As well as, I'm a gardener, I grow my food, I eat my food, I want to live somewhere where I can do that. So I did move to the mainland for 6 years. And I would say what made my life better the most was finding a really amazing doctor who heard my story and said, I want to help you. You are already suffering enough. I don't need to make you suffer just to get your medication. And she was able to give me 3-month prescriptions, which gave me freedom. I could go somewhere. I didn't have to like be somewhere every time, once a month, so that I don't run out of my medication. I could actually travel and live a life more like what I was used to living. So she was amazing. But I had to come back here for various reasons. I own this land. I have renters. My house is falling apart. Financial reasons. And unfortunately, I'm faced with just as backwards of a medical system as before.
I've heard a lot of people say that even who have not had rat lungworm, who will not eat local food anymore, just having heard of it or met somebody who's had it. Many of us who have had experience with the disease are now extremely careful of our food. We make sure everything is washed very well. We've changed a lot of our eating habits. For instance, I normally do not eat salads with lettuce greens anymore. I'll eat sprouts or peeled cucumbers or something like that. Many of us just simply cook our food now. We don't eat a lot of raw food, and really that's typical of how we should really be living in the tropics. It would be a wiser choice.
And we don't eat salads at potlucks unless we know who made it.
Yes, we try to be extremely careful. We don't eat salads or anything like that.
If we go to a restaurant, we don't eat.
You know, if we can't really, we try to eat most all of our meals at home, and we really, if we do go out to eat, we're extremely careful of what we do put into our bodies, because
well, we don't want to get sick.
Yeah, and I know that I wouldn't be able to make it through a second round of this. It's just too hard. I don't know how anyone can.
We're very passionate about growing food and sharing food with people and building community around food, potlucks and gatherings. And so this disease has actually created a lot of fear. I'm very cautious. I'm fearful. It's hard for me to go out and be around a lot of people anymore because my senses are so stimulated. And then when we gather around food, I can't really make those choices. I can't just eat whatever's on the table anymore. I definitely cannot eat salad anymore or any type of food that hasn't been cooked. So our relationship with food has changed tremendously. We don't eat anything that's any green leafy vegetables that are raw any longer. We cook everything, we steam everything. Even if we're gonna make water infusions, I used to put the herb straight in the water and then drink the water, like mint water, but I no longer do that. I boil everything, I cook it all.
I never ate salad from anywhere, the store, the health food store. I didn't grow a garden for 10 years. I just grew my first garden this year since it happened 11 years ago. And I'm actually really motivated to learn to grow my food again in a safe way and helping others, telling others how I do it. Growing only cooking vegetables, and I'm actually starting to grow salad for the first time. I have a particular system. I don't mind using chemical metaldehyde that's in Deadline. I don't use it in my food, but I use it around my food.
Our relationship with our garden and our food has changed because our method of growing food has to change now.
Oh yeah.
We can't just set up a water catchment system and spray it onto our plants like we used to. That was the old way. There's got to be a new way. And so now he and I are focused on how to grow food in this new way and create a module and create a a garden here that's a sample, an example of the new way to grow your food safely so that you can still have a relationship with your food minus the slugs and the rats.
Speaking from my own experience and from a number of other people, it really affects the patient's family. Many of them have to become caregivers, such as I did. They may have to leave their profession to take care of an individual. They may have to come up with the funding to put that person in a long-term care facility. You lose your own income. I went from a professional salary to quite substantially lower salary as a caregiver.
It isn't just the person that gets sick. The caregiver, although you love them dearly and you're right there with them, you are right there with them. That's the thing, you know. I mean, I was up all night long with him, and then I would go to work all day. And of course, it hasn't been easy to lose half an income. That's difficult.
A man that mows my yard, he was also, I believe, exposed to it. He didn't have his case wasn't confirmed, but he had paralysis, and he was very sick, and he couldn't work for
a long time.
6 months.
Yeah, but they didn't have the money to go to the doctor, and they didn't have any insurance.
Well, let's see. I've kind of become the rat lungworm hotline since my son was infected. And it really ranges. A lot of them call me because they're really looking for some help. The medical world can keep you alive for the most part, but there's a lot of lingering symptoms that really there's no cure for, medication, painkillers to suppress pain. But a good number of the people that I've met who have had a hospitalization as a result do have some lingering symptoms. An artist friend of mine was infected about 4 years ago, and she's still on pain medication. So it has degraded the quality of many of their lives. There's a good many people who never have the same quality of their life again, and that's troubling. It's the same with my son, and whether he'll ever have the same quality of life that he would have had without having the disease is pretty questionable. Mm-hmm.
How this has changed our lives, absolutely, completely. You know, you can look at me and say, you look fine. People run into me and they say, oh, you look great, you must be all better. Well, nobody knows when it's pain. Pain is a silent thing. I would really love to see a doctor be interested in us and take our case as something separate from all the other users, just because we might happen to use some of the same drugs. I would like to get medical care. There is no attention on the survivors. And I am calling us survivors and not victims, because we're not victims. But we are survivors. We are the ones who survived, because not everybody survives this. Whether it's suicide or death from another reason, we know that not everybody survives this. And surviving is one thing, but living is another. And there are people I know that have only survived, and they don't live. There is no doctor here that I can go to and say, you know, hey, I'm getting this other symptom that I think is related, because my nervous system is a mess. Can you help me? Uh-uh. The doctor here just writes prescriptions and says goodbye. Yeah. There's no medical care for us, and we need it.
Family RV dealership, quite large. But unfortunately, I wasn't able to continue doing the required sales work and stuff of doing the job every day. I couldn't keep up with all the... Right now, if I have to go anywhere or anything, my wife has to give me list so I remember what I need to do.
When my son was in the hospital, I was visited by a woman. Her husband was a contractor. He lived in Honomu area. And he simply had so much pain, and the quality of life, his life was so degraded that he did kill himself. We've heard other reports of it, but have never been able to verify that.
It's hard. I mean, try going a week with no sleep because you're in pain. You're not going to be in a good mood.
You're not able to work again. You're not able to care for anyone.
Yeah.
You become incapacitated, 100% aid at all times necessary. Mm-hmm. And we have learned of more than one person who have committed suicide because they were in such intense pain, and usually they were by themselves.
Yeah. Without help.
Without help, moral.
And if I didn't have support. Jeremiah, if I didn't have my husband, to help save my life through this situation, I wouldn't be here. I would have checked out because the pain is so intense.
Well, one thing people can do is learn more about it, and that's one of the focuses of our group, is to try to increase awareness through education. And if you know about it, at least you can take some steps to prevent it. For example, really checking and washing your vegetables, your fresh vegetables, rat control, slug and snail control, all of those things can help reduce the risk of infection.
I think the word is getting out. Myself, I didn't know anything about this disease, and I was an educator in Waimea and had a large school garden that we had put in. We've done a lot of work to try to educate people. At the beginning of when I started working with Sue, we went to one of the high schools here in Hilo that had an agricultural program and asked the students how many of you had heard of rat lungworm, and of 60 plus students, only one had kind of heard of it vaguely. So I feel that our efforts are raising awareness. We do hear more people saying, yes, I do know about it, but there's still a lot of myths. A lot of people say, oh, well, I wash my vegetables with vinegar or hydrogen peroxide or something like that. And now we have been able to do those studies and look, are these things effective? And we're able to see that most of them, no, are not effective. So we're able to tell people, you know, don't trust that. You know, it's got to be better than that.
So that's really my goal, is to spread education and awareness and to use our experience and our story to initiate change, this most definite change that is coming. There's change happening, and more people will know about this disease and these nematodes and these worms and the slugs and the rats and the whole life cycle and all of the animals that they affect. And we just have to adapt. Right? In Hawaii, that's what we do best. We adapt. And there's also an element of prayer, because you pray that you don't ever get this again. You pray that this is the one time you ever get it, and this never happens again, because once is enough.
Yeah.
To live through this twice, I have heard there's people who've had it two or three times.
You should not have even have had it once.
You shouldn't even have had it once.
And that's what our goal is, to prevent this from happening even once.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I wish this on nobody. And I pray that nobody else gets sick from this, but I'm afraid if they don't act soon, it's just going to spread and more people are going to get sick. This is not going to go away by just burying our heads in the sand. People's lives are being destroyed, and I think it's time that we should do something. I'm willing to help. I mean, if there's something I can do, please ask me. I will do everything I can.
I don't think this has to keep making people sick, except very, very rarely, if people are educated about how to treat their food and if the medical profession is educated on how to treat people who come in sick with it. It's just a failure on all those levels at this point, because, you know, it just hasn't been done yet. So you're doing it now, so that's wonderful.
Yeah. Thank
so
you.
So we're happy to help. And believe me, she was so sick. I mean, I had pain, but she was really, really in agony. And I don't ever want to see anybody go through that again. Jeez.
I really appreciate getting this opportunity to talk about what's important to me. There needs to be education. There needs to be medical help for the survivors.
Yeah.
If that doesn't happen, more and more and more people are going to get sick, and it just ruins your life. All I want is to live as normal a life as possible. That's all I ask. I have to live my whole life with this. I have to live my whole life on medication, probably. And I just want to be treated humanely. Yeah. That's really all I ask.
Yeah.
And I want the other people in my position to also be treated humanely.
I've contacted a number of people at different levels in both federal and state government because this, I felt, was a really big problem. I'm a well-educated person. I was working as an educator in Hawaii. I'm very connected with food and the gardening movement, and I'd never heard of this. And I contacted Michelle Obama. You know, she's a very much a school garden advocate. And I received a nice generic reply, thank you for your what you're doing, and a picture of the first family. But that was it. And we've contacted, I was a Department of Ag employee as I was working to get into the graduate program that I'm in. And I contacted Russell Kokobun, who was then the head of the Ag Department, and mentioned I worked as a state Ag employee in the honeybee program, but that this was my real passion, and I never received a reply back from him, you know, stating that this was, I felt, a big problem for Hawaii, and we needed funding for research and education. I never received a reply. We contacted Governor David Ige when he was elected and congratulated him on his election and sent him a copy of our activity book and a brochure that we had created here at the College of Pharmacy, and we never received a reply. We've requested a meeting with the head of the health department since last fall of 2014, but have yet to have our request met.
And I'd like to see the medical centers and the healthcare practitioners in Hilo and Hawaii Island and Hawaii State to become more aware of this disease and stop turning people away. Because if I was treated when I first went in with my symptoms, I wouldn't have this nerve damage. I wouldn't be in this place I am.
After the big outbreak happened and more people on our street started getting sick, and we live in a small neighborhood of three streets, and you know, there are eight people that I know of just in that small area that were ill with rat lungworm. And so I ended up saying, I'm just going to call the Department of Health. And after explaining what environmentally was going on, you know, here, and the number of people getting sick and how awful a disease it was, the assistant to the director told me at the time, this was in like 2006, said, that's the price of living in paradise.
The CDC came to my house 11 years ago. They, like a big gang of them, flew out from Georgia and took samples, and they're like, we're going to help you, we're going to help you. You know, obviously nothing became of it.
Well, it's interesting, you know, we have a dog, and for a lot of the time, she would travel back and forth with us. And it's interesting to me that Hawaii has such strict quarantine laws on dogs because they're worried about rabies, as they should be, and that's a great thing. But if you think of all the expense and time that goes into controlling that, it makes one wonder why they don't want to get this under control.
For our visitors and people traveling around the world, you know that certain countries, certain places you go, when you get there, you land there, there are signs. Oh, don't drink the water. This is what's going on. Oh, there's an outbreak of, just to be, understand that there are preventions available.
Yes.
Simple little sign at the bus stop, at the airport, for people who don't know, just to be on a lookout for these things.
No, there's no information about it. People get off the plane, there should be something with all those big magazines there. But they're not going to do that because it would affect the tourism rate too much. It's unbelievable, the lack of knowledge. At this point, people are scared. After this recent death, I would say there's a huge fear factor up there. That fear does not equal awareness.
I guess I would say that this disease radically changed my life. I've been a single mom since my children's dad died when they were quite young. was finally to a point where I could have a professional degree, profession going, and this disease really changed that. In some respects, I've been incredibly grateful to work with Dr. Jarvie at the College of Pharmacy, to be in a graduate program now and doing the research on this work, and to be able to go out into the community and work with the school gardens in particular and help educate them so that they know how to handle this. But it's been a tremendous financial burden. My son, I don't know that he'll ever be recovered. We're hoping that at some point in time he is able to work again. He was 24 years old, just turned 24 years old when he was infected. He's now 30 years old and still suffers from neurological damage from this. So it's definitely impacted my life, and I know that others who have had less, the outcome has not been as well if they've gone so deep as to go into a coma, still severely debilitated in wheelchairs, on ventilators. So I'm grateful that we've had such a good recovery, but we turn to much alternative medicine to help him recover, and that was not covered by insurance. So it buries you in a financial hole, this disease does, and I think that it's time for recognition to be paid for it.
A few years back in 2011, one of my colleagues at UH Manoa invited me over to attend what at that point in time was the second international rat lungworm working group. And so I went over and met a group of people that from around the world that had been working on research in rat lungworm disease. And I met Kay Howe, and Kay's son Graham was infected with rat lungworm. And I had heard about rat lungworm disease prior to that, but I didn't realize how serious it could be until I met Kay and Graham. And then shortly afterwards, we started the Rat Lungworm Working Group, and we have been doing a number of different, both educational and research studies. We've developed a rat lungworm activity book that the College of Pharmacy provided funding for printing, 10,000 copies of that. We only have about 200 or 300 copies left, so we've distributed a lot of these books in East Hawaii and elsewhere. Hawaii needs better collaboration between the federal and the state agencies and research institutions. That would be really helpful. We need funding. It's very difficult to get funding, especially at the larger institutions, NIH, NSF, when the review panel has never even heard of rat lungworm disease. And one of the reasons we're running this prevalence study is to, because I think we will demonstrate that the prevalence of disease or exposure to the parasite is much higher than what's currently being reported, which would make it a more significant disease in terms of trying to obtain funding from it. And also, you know, it is on the mainland, and it's going to be a growing problem on the mainland as well. Rat lungworm disease affects everybody, from tourism, we have had tourists that have been infected and they go back to the mainland, and of course the physicians don't really know how to treat it. People are getting nervous about eating local fresh produce, so it affects agriculture. Also, even our animals can become infected. Horses, there have been several cases of horses where they've had to be euthanized. Because of rat lungworm disease, it affects dogs, you know. So there's a lot of areas, and it's a widespread problem. It's not just east side of Hawaii. We have had cases in Maui and on Oahu. We've had recent cases in Kona. So it's not just the Puna area.